Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillah wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillahi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa man walah amma ba'd. So we spent around 3 weeks talking about the Isra and Mi'raj of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and we went over the benefits and the details of al-Isra. And just as the Prophet ﷺ returned to Mecca and life resumed, so too we also need to return back to Mecca and resume with the seerah from where we left it off. Now, remember we had talked about the death of Abu Talib and the fact that the protection that the Prophet ﷺ enjoyed being from the Banu Hashim, initially Abu Lahab felt obligated to give him the protection, and then within a week or two, he rescinded it, cancelled it. And so who can tell me who took over the protection? Who could tell me how was the process of living in Mecca? Yes. No, not Abu Talib. He had passed away. He had died. Who was giving him the protection? Yes. Close. Mut'im. Yeah, actually, right. Mut'im ibn Adi, mashallah, you're right. My son corrected me. Okay. Mut'im. Mut'im ibn Adi. Mut'im ibn Adi was the one who had given protection to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and it was under the protection of Mut'im that he had been living. Now, this was a very precarious situation, very awkward. Why is it awkward? Because his own tribe has abandoned him. The Banu Hashim has abandoned him. And Jubair is from another tribe. And it's a very awkward situation that the Quraysh is not too happy with what's going on. Also, Mut'im himself was a very elderly man, very old man. And in fact, after the Prophet immigrated, Mut'im passed away within a year. Within a year. Before the Battle of Badr, Mut'im died. Before the Battle of Badr, he had already died. And therefore, it's a very awkward situation. And so the Prophet realizes he needs to leave Mecca. He's already tried Ta'if. Ta'if has failed him. So what does he do now? The Prophet ﷺ began going to the tribes that used to come for Hajj and presenting himself. The Arabic word is يَعْرِضُ نَفْسَهُ عَرَضَ نَفْسَهُ, presenting himself to the tribes, asking any of them to sponsor him, to transfer allegiance. Now this was something known but very rare. The Arabs had this concept that sometimes somebody had to change tribes for a political reason, for a dramatic reason. Sometimes it would be for a marriage reason, that a person might choose the tribe if, let's say, the tribe of the woman said, we will only marry you if you come to our tribe. So the concept was there of changing tribes, but it was a rare concept. And the Prophet ﷺ therefore utilized this concept by approaching the various tribes during Hajj. Now, what happened during Hajj? We already mentioned Hajj was a phenomenon that was coming from the time of Ibrahim alayhi salam. Just like in our times, every country would send representatives, right? And what happens in Mina? In Mina, Mina is divided up into zones. Just like in our times, you have the Americans are here, right? The Nigerians are here, the Iranians are here, the Chinese Muslims are here. It was exactly the same, except that it wasn't nations, it was qaba'il. There were tribes that had spots in Mina. Every tribe knew where we're going to camp. It was something customary. And so the Prophet ﷺ would utilize the fact people are coming to him. And he would then approach the tribes, and he began doing this in earnest. Now, there are records that he was doing this from before the death of Abu Talib, but he was only doing it for da'wah reasons. He was not asking them to adopt him. Right, so he's simply approaching the tribes to preach Islam. There are records of this, that he's going to the tribes to preach Islam. And later on we'll mention, perhaps even we know of some pseudo-converts who had accepted Islam, or maybe not. We'll find out some more details later on. But the key is, before the death of Abu Talib, he's not approaching them to ask for political asylum. He's approaching them for da'wah. After the death of Abu Talib, the tune changes. And it is not just accepting Islam, but it is also political asylum. And there are numerous reports from eyewitnesses from the other tribes, some of whom were not, in fact, all of whom were not Muslim at the time, reporting what the Prophet ﷺ would say. And of them is the story of Rabi'a ibn Abbad, who said that when he was a young child, he remembers as a young man, coming to Mina, his father was the chieftain of their tribe, coming to Mina, and he says, I remember a young man coming. He was a child. He remembers a young man coming, The Prophet was not young at this time, but clearly his beard was all black at this time. So the child remembers a young man. A young man coming and speaking to my father, telling him to embrace the worship of Allah and leave idolatry and to accept him into his tribe. And he said, I saw a man standing behind him, waiting for him to finish. An elderly man wearing a Yemeni cloak, having two ponytails. The Arabs had ponytails. Men would have ponytails. Islam came and said, generally speaking, men should not be doing this. But the Arabs of old, they had dhu'ab. They would braid their hair. You know, the masculine ponytails, which is common now in some cultures. They have these masculine ponytails. So he had these two ponytails coming out. And he was wearing a Yemeni cloak, elderly man, waiting in the background. When this young man finished and moved to the next tent, this elderly man came forward and said, O people, this is a person who's calling you to give up your gods, Allat and Al-Uzza. And he's calling you to give up the way of your forefathers, so do not give up that way and stay with the way of your forefathers. So Rabi'a said, I asked my father, who is this young man and who is the older man who came to cancel what he said? So his father said, this is the young man they claim is a prophet. So people have heard of a man claiming to be a prophet. And that elderly man is his uncle Abdul Uzza, meaning Abu Lahab. That elderly man is his uncle Abdul Uzza ibn Abdul Muttalib. So the matter of the Prophet had become a bit of a common knowledge now. This is the man who claims to be a prophet. So his matter had spread amongst the tribes, and the Prophet kept on going tribe to tribe. In another narration reported by many of the classical books of Seerah, the Prophet ﷺ said, who will take me, who will adopt me basically, so that I may preach the message of Islam, the message of La ilaha illallah, because Quraysh has prevented me from preaching the kalam of Allah. Quraysh has stopped me from preaching the kalam of Allah. And therefore, the Prophet ﷺ is calling people not only to Islam, but also to accept him politically, to adopt him politically. And the Prophet ﷺ approached multiple tribes. He approached of the tribes that we know, the famous tribe of Kinda, the tribe of Banu Abdullah ibn Kalb, the tribe of Banu Hanifa, the tribe of Banu Amir ibn Sa'sa'a. All of these tribes, they rejected the message, some of them more harshly than others. Some of them more harshly than others. Some of them were rude, some of them were sarcastic, and some of them did it more politely. So we have a number of interesting stories about what happened with these tribes. Two or three interesting stories. One of these is from the tribe of Kinda. The tribe of Kinda was a tribe that once upon a time had a lot more prestige than now. They were a glorious tribe of old. And they were one of the few Arab tribes that actually had something of a king. They had a kingdom once upon a time in their land. Once upon a time, maybe 500 or 400 years ago, and they had lost that prestige, and now they were simply the stories of old, but they had lost the power that they used to have. So when the Prophet ﷺ approached the chieftain of Kinda, or one of the chieftains of Kinda, because again, remember, the way that the tribal system works, there is no one leader for the whole tribe. You have leaders of every sub-tribe coming together in a parliamentary system, if you like, right? So, for example, Abu Talib in his lifetime was not the chieftain of Quraysh. He was the chieftain of the Banu Hashim. And Mut'im was the chieftain of the Banu Makhzum, and so on and so forth, right? And so each of the sub-tribes has their chieftain, and it's not as if there's one king. That's one of the signs of a Jahili society. There's no unified civilization. No one person is in charge. And we already mentioned Abdul Muttalib had almost broken that and almost become the unified leader of the Quraysh, but even he did not become the king. So he approached one of the chieftains of the Kinda. His name does not concern us, will confuse me more by the names. And the chieftain listened with great attention. And he said, this is a very interesting message. Come with me, I will grant you an audience with our other chieftains, i.e. the other elite. Come with me, I'll grant you an audience, and what you said to me, say to them. So the Prophet ﷺ followed him. They went into the gathering, and he convened the gathering, and the Prophet ﷺ preached the message to them. Then the man who had brought him in spoke up. So he has He's thinking two steps ahead. And he said, "Oh my fellow tribesmen, if we were to take this matter from this young man," again he called him a young man, because again the Prophet is now in his late 50s, and so the elders, the chieftains, would be definitely in their 60s and 70s. So yani he's just calling him, he's still relatively young to compare to the chieftains. "If we were to take this young man from the Quraysh and adopt him, we will have a message through which we can conquer the other Arabs." Notice, he's thinking politically. This man is coming with his message, I have my message. What is my message? To regain the glory of Kinda, to regain the tribal ancestry, the kingdom of Kinda. He's presenting me with a message that will allow me to devour the other Arabs, i.e. to control and rule the other Arabs. So he's telling the tribes, this is why I invited him in, right? Think not in terms of theology, in terms of politics. Think not in terms of iman, in terms of the fact you're coming with something new. It's interesting, it's exciting, the Arabs are going to follow it, and we will have a different ethics and a different code that we can then use to conquer the other Arabs. So then he turned to the Prophet and said, "Now tell me, if we were to follow you in this matter of yours, and then Allah gives us victory over all those who are your enemies." He's being very political here. "If we were to join you and Allah gives us victory over your enemies, will you give us control of this affair after you?" Meaning, will we be the rulers after you? You can be the ruler as long as you're alive, no problem. But once you're gone, will it return to Kinda? So the Prophet ﷺ said, very accurately and correctly, "Inna al-arḍa lillahi yurithuha man yasha'u min 'ibadihi," that the kingdom, the mulk, belongs to Allah, the land belongs to Allah, and Allah gives it to whomever He pleases. Notice the beauty, he didn't say yes, he didn't say no. He said, this is a condition I cannot agree to. Allah Azza wa Jal is the one who owns this earth. But he is seeing that the reason they want to embrace the faith is not genuine iman, it is politics. And so he's not attracted himself to this group. And he says, "Inna al-arḍa lillahi yurithuha man yasha'u min 'ibadihi." So this chieftain said, "So you're asking us to follow you, stick our necks out behind you in order to have them cut off," meaning this war, "and then after we have spilled our blood and you have used it to conquer the Arabs, then you will take the kingdom? Go, we have no need of this." So the whole point for them was politics. The Kinda wanted to regain their kingdom of old, and they did not find any use in a message that would not give them power. And look at the wisdom and also the sincerity and also the firmness of the Prophet ﷺ. He is, yani Allah has placed him in a very precarious situation. If one were to say it is desperate, it would not be far from the truth. He needs somebody to sponsor him. And the Kinda tribe is one of the superpower tribes of the Arabs. It is one of the heavyweights. It is rivaling the Quraysh. It used to be much more powerful than the Quraysh. The Kinda tribe is definitely one of the heavyweights of the entire peninsula. And so they're asking him to compromise, and yet he cannot compromise on the message. You're not going to gain victory by compromising what is a part of your religion. And so the Prophet ﷺ said, "No, we are not going to give you this condition." And because of this, he gave up an opportunity that many of us, were we to try to do it in our times, we would have no problems compromising much more than this. But the Prophet ﷺ realized two things. Firstly, he's not allowed to compromise the message. Secondly, this group of people will not be true believers. And Allah helps this religion through true believers, and not through the power and might of Kinda or of any other tribe. And so the Prophet ﷺ went on his way. Another story we have is that of the Banu Shayban ibn Tha'laba, which is an interesting story. It doesn't give us many morals, but it shows us that some people weren't interested for genuine reasons. The Banu Shayban ibn Tha'laba. Generally, the Prophet ﷺ would go with Abu Bakr. Why? Because Abu Bakr was the expert of genealogy, of nasab, of ansab. And Abu Bakr knew more about the ansab of the Arabs than any other person. And therefore, whenever they would go to a people, Abu Bakr would tell the Prophet ﷺ, this is Fulan ibn Fulan. This is the tribe of Fulan ibn Fulan. And of their positives is this. And of the things you should be aware of is that. And of their leaders is so and so. And this shows us that the Prophet ﷺ would take advantage of the knowledge of the people. That Abu Bakr had a type of knowledge, and the Prophet ﷺ took advantage of this. There is no question that he is Rasulullah, that Allah is inspiring him. But his perfection and his isma comes in religious knowledge. It comes in how to worship Allah. Comes in ibadah, rituals, theology. As for the matters of this world, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sometimes chose to give him more than anybody, and sometimes he didn't, in which case he took advantage of the people of knowledge. And if this is the case of our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that he had no qualms benefiting from other people's knowledge and experience, where do we stand? And this is multiplied many times in the seerah, right? And this is something, by the way, many Muslim groups find amazing or awkward. How could the Prophet have benefited from the knowledge of other people? But we keep on telling and seeing in the seerah the humanity of Rasulullah. He is indeed Rasulullah, but he is not Alimul Ghaybi wa Shahada. He doesn't have Ilmul Zahir and Ilmul Batin. And Abu Bakr spent more years studying genealogy than even the Prophet ﷺ. And so the Prophet ﷺ had no problem that Abu Bakr advised him and tell him about the positives and negatives about each and every tribe. So when they go to this tribe, Abu Bakr asks them, he is with the Prophet ﷺ. Abu Bakr says greetings and says the salam and asks them, Man al-qawm, which is the polite way of asking, you know, who are you? Because you cannot recognize them by seeing them. Who are you? So they say, we are the Banu Shayban ibn Tha'laba. So the Prophet ﷺ, Abu Bakr leans over to the Prophet ﷺ and says, Ya Rasulullah, the Banu Shayban are of the most noble and the most illustrious and the most intelligent tribes of the Arabs. I.e. these are people who are valued for their wisdom. And they have amongst them Fulan and Fulan and Fulan. He mentioned their tribal leaders. They have amongst them these people who are known for their karam, for their generosity, for their sincerity. So Abu Bakr knows all of this. And so he's preparing the Prophet ﷺ that these are people of intelligence. So they exchange some pleasantries back and forth. And they ask, who are you? They say, Abu Bakr says, I am the son of Abu Qahafa from the Quraysh. And this is the grandson of Abdul Muttalib. So they introduce themselves. And then the Banu Shayban say, what is your matter? Why are you here, basically, right? In other words, it's not the custom of the Arabs or the Quraysh to go knocking on tents. There's a reason you're coming. So, what is the matter? What is the issue that you are here with? And so here the Prophet ﷺ spoke. So Abu Bakr introduced him. Abu Bakr was his press secretary here. He was his ambassador, opening the doors. Once the doors are open, the pleasantries are finished, then the Prophet ﷺ speaks up. And the Prophet ﷺ says, We have come here to invite you to ibadatillahi azza wa jal. That ibadatillahi wahdahu la sharika la. And that you reject the false gods. And we also ask you to accept us, to take us into your tribe, because the Quraysh has asat wa baghat, they have been arrogant and they have been evil and they have rejected us, or they have stopped us from prevented us from spreading the speech of Allah. And Allah is al-ghani al-hamid. I am asking for your help, but Allah does not need your help. I am asking for your help, but then he finishes, and Allah is al-ghani al-hamid. Right? So don't think that Allah needs you. We are saying, help us out if you want, and Allah will reward you. But Allah Azza wa Jal is Ghani and Hamid. So the tribal leader said, what else? Is there anything more than this? So the Prophet ﷺ recited to them the famous verse of Surah Al-Anfal. قُلْ تَعَالَوْا أَتْلُ مَا حَرَّمَ رَبُّكُمْ عَلَيْكُمْ أَلَّا تُشْرِكُوا بِهِ شَيْئًا وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا. Say, come, I will tell you what your Lord has forbidden for you. That you don't worship any besides Him. You don't do shirk with Him. And you be good to your parents, and you be good to your relatives, and the verse goes on, and you don't eat the property of orphans, and you do this, and you do that, and you do not do fahisha, and you be trustworthy in your judgment. So it's all about ayat of ethics and morality. The chieftain said, anything more than this? The Prophet ﷺ said, إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون. So he gave a brief khutbah basically, and it can be said that this ayah, because the Prophet ﷺ used it, it has become a custom to use this ayah in every single khutbah till Jum'ah, even though he didn't use it in khutbah till Jum'ah, but he used it in this khutbah, and it shows us the comprehensiveness of this ayah, that إن الله تعالى إن الله يأمر بالعدل, that Allah commands to everything that is just, والإحساني, and perfection of manners, وإيتاء ذي القربى, and to be good to one's relatives, وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي, and Allah forbids lewd deeds and transgressions and evils. يَعِذُكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَذَكَّرُونَ. Allah is admonishing you so that you think and you be rightly guided. So the chieftain said, you have indeed come with good, and you have called us to the best of akhlaq and morals, i.e. your message is very good, and the Quraysh has lied against you. Notice, even before the Prophet ﷺ has come, they know the Quraysh has come. They know what the Quraysh has said, and they're aware, and this is an important point, the message of the Prophet or the phenomenon of the Prophet ﷺ had spread amongst the Arabs. And even the Banu Shayban, they've never met the Prophet ﷺ. They know that somebody is from the Quraysh who has some message that they have already been warned against. And when he presents the message, they tell him, the Quraysh have already lied against you, and your message is not what they have said. So I refer you to our Shaykh, our elder, Hani ibn Qais. Hani ibn Qais stood up and he said, I have heard what you have said, O member of Quraysh. Ya akha Quraysh, which is basically their way of saying, O person of Quraysh, I have heard what you have said. And I feel that if we leave our religion and our ways and embrace your ways after a first meeting, we've never met before, we haven't met again yet, i.e. the first meeting, this will be a hasty decision, and it might cause us harm in the long run. And we also have people we have left behind. Not everybody comes for Hajj. What percentage come for Hajj, right? We have also people that we have left behind whose advice we have not sought on this matter and whose support is necessary. And so I think that we should wait, and you should wait, and we shall return, and you shall return, i.e. next year. This is an intelligent response. And I also ask the advice of our military leader, Al-Muthanna ibn Haritha. Muthanna, what do you have to say? Notice, clearly Abu Bakr was right when he said, these are wise people, these are intelligent people, these are people of nobility. No one man is making a decision. They're all referring to their elders. What do you say? What do you say? What do you say? And when their elder, the most elderly person speaks, it is actually a very wise speech. What does he say? Look, I've only met you once. We can't just accept your message, even though it sounds interesting, without thinking about it, without asking our people. And this is, if we just are hasty here, we might come later on to regret it, and neither you nor us will be happy about this. So give us time, you take time. Let us go back to our people, and we will come back again. Muthanna, what do you have to say? Muthanna was their military chief. Muthanna said, what our elder Hani has said is true, and we will not take any hasty decision in this matter. And there is another matter as well. So, Muthanna brings another problem. We are a group of Arabs who have loyalties and treaties with two groups of people. Number one, our neighboring Arab tribes, and he mentions them, no need to go into more details. And number two, Kisra. Who is Kisra? La, Kisra is Laysa Azim al-Rum. Qaisar is Azim al-Rum. Kisra is the Sassanid emperor. Kisra is the Sassanid. So clearly, these are people who are living in the bordering regions of the Persian Empire. So they're saying, we have two groups of treaties. Number one, with the Arabs around us, this would be towards the south. Number two, with the Persians, this would be towards the north, or towards the east, right? So Muthanna said, as for the Arabs, we don't have any fear or worry about them. Whatever we do, we'll be able to manage our affairs. But as for Kisra, we have a deal with him. to be neutral in all affairs in the Arabian Peninsula. We have a deal with him to be neutral. And look at Muthanna, this is a very wise statement, shows the guy knows what he's talking about, shows he's an intelligent politician and military leader. And this matter of yours does not seem to be something the kings would approve of. You're bringing something strange. So, he said, if we were to accept it, it would only be on the Arab side. We're going to be half Muslims. If we were to accept it, it would only be in our dealings with the Arabs and not with our dealings with Kisra. So the military leader brings forth a condition and he basically says, we would not be able to do anything for you or against you vis-a-vis the Persians. You want us to help you against the Arabs? If we choose to do so, we will do it. We're not worried about the Arabs. But Kisra, now this is a superpower. Kisra, this is the Sassanid Empire. You know, the Sassanids and the Romans were at each other's throats for 350 years, right? This was a mighty nation. This was a mighty nation. And each one, every few decades, would have victory over the other. We already talked about Alif Lam Mim Ghulibat al-Rum. Did we? I get confused sometimes. We didn't talk about this one yet? Huh? Not yet? Okay, we will inshallah. It will come in the Seerah. Alif Lam Mim Ghulibat al-Rum fi adna al-ardi wa hum ba'da ghalibin sayghlibuna fi bid'i sinin. The Romans and the Persians were at each other's throats. For 350 years, there was a battle between them. And Kisra and his empire is a mighty empire. The Persian Empire controls what? What is now Iran, what is now Iraq, what is now Afghanistan, what is now Tashkent, Uzbekistan. This is a massive empire. And the Romans are, of course, they began at the border of Syria now, right? The border of Syria and Iraq, roughly this region, is where the border of the Sassanids and the Romans, they were fighting each other, right? Some of you have seen this ancient movie, 300. Remember that, not that I'm using istishada, but to make people understand. This movie, 300, is basically about this war between the Romans and the Persians. Not that I'm telling you to watch movies here. But I'm saying sometimes you guys don't know history. We tell you this is what the history is about, right? And this is a romanticized version of the Roman and the Persian wars between these two superpowers. So this Arab tribe said, we don't want any problems with the Persians. We don't want any problems with the Persians. If you want, we'll be Muslims with the Arabs, basically. Not with the Persians. And so the Prophet ﷺ responded, your response has been good and has been sincere. You're being fair. And you're being fair about your concerns. But, listen to this, Allah's religion will only be helped by those who have embraced it fully. Allah's religion will only be helped by those who have embraced it fully. And so, for example, he basically says this condition is not acceptable. There's no such thing as half Muslims. Allah's deen will only be helped by those. And Allah says in the Quran, يَا أَيُّهَا آمَنُوا أُدْخُلُوا فِي السِّلْمِ كَافَّةً. It doesn't work if you're half Muslim. The Quraysh tried this before. One day kafir, one day Muslim. And what did Allah say? قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا الْكَافِرُونَ لَا أَعْبُدُ مَا تَعْبُدُونَ وَلَا أَنْتُمْ عَبْدُونَ مَا عَبْدُ وَلَا أَنَا عَبْدٌ مَا عَبْدُتُمْ وَلَا أَنْتُمْ عَبْدُونَ مَا عَبْدُتُمْ لَكُمْ دِينُكُمْ وَلِيَ دِينِ. You can't be half-half, right? And so the Prophet ﷺ stood up to leave with Abu Bakr, and then he said, and what if I were to tell you, and what if I were to tell you that this matter of Kisra, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will grant you victory over the kingdom of Kisra. And you will enjoy their land and their money and their captive women. Would you then accept, if I were to promise you this? One of their younger ones said, yes, of course, bala, there's no question we would do this, right? But they didn't believe that this would actually happen. How could it happen when the Roman Empire could not destroy the Persian Empire? Are you expecting us, the Banu Shayban, to be able to conquer the Sassanids? And so the Prophet ﷺ left them at this, and they did not embrace Islam at this stage. Of course, later on in the Fath Makkah phase, everybody embraced Islam, right? But they gave up embracing Islam now, and because they gave it up now, They gave up all of the riches and fortunes that the Ansar and the Muhajirun acquired. And this is an amazing prediction that subhanAllah, even though the Prophet ﷺ seems to be in a very dire situation, he has yaqeen in Allah. That these lands, it's only a matter of time. That you're scared of Kisra, the time will come when you will be enjoying the palaces of Kisra. All of that wealth will be yours, if you only had faith. And what is really amazing is that this prediction was for Kisra and not Qaisar. Yani Allah's promise is specific and true. Because had it been for Qaisar, it still hasn't happened yet. But for Kisra, what happened with Kisra? When the Prophet ﷺ sent his letter to Kisra, right? And Kisra, what did Kisra do? You all know, what did Kisra do? Tore the letter up, right? The Prophet ﷺ said, because they tore my letter up, Allah will yumazziqhum kulla mumazzaq. Allah will tear their kingdom up like He tore my letter up. And for 400 years, the Roman Empire could not damage the Persian Empire like the Muslims dissolved it in 2 years. It is an amazing, and to this day, by the way, historians are mystified. To this day, historians are completely astounded. How could this have happened? How it is literally, I mean, if anybody were to have predicted that the Persian Empire would collapse, this would have been considered something, you've gone crazy. And in fact, the opposite was true, that there was a feeling that the Roman Empire would collapse because the Persians were so strong. Alif Lam Mim, غُلِبَتِ الرُّومِ. That's the whole point. The Persians won. And there was this fear that the Roman Empire would have to give up Syria and Damascus for the Persians, because Damascus was the key. Damascus was where the Persians were aiming for, right? Little did they realize that Syria and Damascus would come into Muslim hands and the Persian Empire in its entirety would collapse. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made them كَخَبَرِ كَانَ. There was nothing left of them. Just like fables and tales and legends left. And it is one of the most astounding incidents in history if you understand what the Persian Empire was. The might. And if you see, even on, log on to Google and just type in the Sassanid Empire and see the images, their palaces in Tessiphon, the pillars just go out of the middle of the desert. Pillars that are like 50 meters high or something, just amazing, massive palaces in the middle of nowhere. And this mighty civilization was conquered by literally a group of Bedouins who had converted to a new faith. Without military might, without the power, without the cavalry. You all know Rabi' ibn Amr and his story. Rabi' ibn Amr and his story with the emperor, the Persian emperor, Rustum, right? Well, that Rustum basically said, what are you guys doing here? We're going to kill you tomorrow. Go back and we'll ignore that you ever, you know, irritated us and scratched us. Rustum said to Rabi' ibn Amr, have you gone crazy? You're coming from your land to attack us with what? And for what? Go back and we'll just forget about all this, right? And of course, Rustum gave that brave response, right? That we have come out from our land, لِنُخْرِجَ الْعِبَادَ مِنْ عِبَادَةِ الْعِبَادِ إِلَىٰ عِبَادَةِ رَبِّ الْعِبَادِ. To get people out of the worship of other people and to embrace them into the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And of course, go on and on. And it is amazing that within 2 years, the entire Sassanid Empire crumbled and collapsed, and it became into non-existent history of the past. All of these lands, Iraq, Iran, Khorasan, Afghanistan, Uzbekistan, Tajikistan, all of these lands, within a few years of the death of the Prophet ﷺ, were all in Muslim lands and under Islamic control. And this is something the Prophet ﷺ told to the Bani Shayban. Would you believe me if I told you that it's only a matter of time? And literally, the same people whom he's speaking to were the ones who conquered the Sassanid Empire. Not 10 generations, not 2 generations, the same group of people, if only they had faith. You're scared of Kisra? Would you believe me if I told you that you are going to be sharing their land? This shows us his yaqeen, that even though it is a desperate situation, he has trust in Allah. And subhanAllah, this is exactly what happened. So, we have some interesting stories, as we said, of some of these, and there are other stories as well. Of course, the main story that we're going to then take from here is the story of a small group of people who came from a city that the Prophet ﷺ was not too familiar with its people, even though he had visited it. once or twice because he had akhwal, he had relatives from his mother's side, his father's side. His father's grandmother was from Yathrib. He had relatives there, so he had visited it once, and on the way, it was on the way back from Yathrib that his mother had passed away. Remember that they had gone and visited Yathrib. So it was a group from Yathrib, from a small obscure tribe that didn't register with the Prophet ﷺ immediately, that the story of Islam would take a whole different turn. And before we get to there, we need to talk about the city of Yathrib. The city of Yathrib was composed of three main groups of people, two of whom were Arab and one large group of Yahud. The Arab tribes were the Aus and the Khazraj. And the Yahud, we're going to talk about them in a lot more detail in a few months, but for now, they were the Banu Nadir, the Banu Qaynuqa, and the Banu Qurayza. Where did they come from? How did they get in the middle of Arabia? This is something we'll talk about later on. But for around 100 or so years, the city of Yathrib had been a flourishing oasis. It wasn't an ancient city. It was a relatively modern city. And it had one of the only areas in the entire Arabian Peninsula where the Yahud were living. Yathrib and Khaybar were the only areas in the entire Hijaz where there were Yahud. The closest Yahud were in Yemen, far, far away. There was no other Yahud in the entire Arabian Peninsula. So, the year that Abu Talib died, that's the 10th year of the da'wah, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam met the first group of the people of Yathrib who were to convert to Islam. And there were a number of things that happened in Yathrib that facilitated this conversion. The most important was a battle that is called the Battle of Bu'ath, Harbi Bu'ath or Yomi Bu'ath. The Battle of Bu'ath, that was the culmination of a civil war between the Aus and the Khazraj that lasted for over a decade. So, the Aus and the Khazraj were having a civil war, minor skirmishes, over typical Bedouin issues, land rights, watering rights, grazing rights, typical stuff that just gets bigger and bigger, right? One person gets killed, two person retaliate, 10%, typical standard stuff that happens. Small things get bigger and bigger and bigger until finally they had a major all-out battle. And that was the most severe battle that the Aus and Khazraj ever had, and that was the Battle of Bu'ath. And this battle, it took place around 3 years before, or 2.5 years before this meeting, i.e. around 4 to 5 years before the Hijrah, right? Aisha says, listen to this narration from Sahih Bukhari, Aisha says, the day of Bu'ath, i.e. the civil war, was a gift that Allah gave to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allah works in his own ways. The day of Bu'ath was a gift that Allah gave to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Why is it a gift? How is it a gift? Aisha explains. It was because of Bu'ath that their unity had been completely fragmented and their leaders had been completely decimated. The Battle of Bu'ath killed the bulk of the senior members of the Aus and the Khazraj. It was such a severe battle that it killed the bulk of their leaders. And those who were left were generally the younger generation. And this younger generation had seen 10 years of blood and war. And they're sick of it. And so they are wanting something new. And they're wanting something that will give them meaning and purpose in life. And they themselves are young, not old. And so youngsters are easier to think and change. Elders are set in their ways. There was one senior member of Yathrib who had not died in the Battle of Bu'ath. Only one. And that was Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul. It's the only senior member who survived the Battle of Bu'ath. And it was his seniority that gave him that kibr and that nifaq that he was to become the leader of later on. Because he was the undisputed leader of Medina in terms of seniority and rank. And had it not been for Islam, there would be no opposition to him and against him. He was the senior member that is remaining behind. And so eventually he, of course, becomes the leader of the Munafiq. I'm jumping the gun here. Let's get back to what is going on. Now, before the Prophet ﷺ met these people, there are indications that the message of Islam had already reached Medina. And of them, the story is that of Suwayd ibn Samir. Suwayd ibn Samit. Suwayd ibn Samit was from the Banu Auf, which is from the Khazraj. And Suwayd ibn Samit was the poet of the Khazraj. He heard that there is this magician / poet in the Quraysh. News of the Prophet ﷺ spread to him. So when he went for Hajj, this is before the Battle of Bu'ath. This is before all of this. This is before the Prophet ﷺ is asking political asylum. This is when he's just preaching Tawheed. So when he went to Mecca for Hajj, he hunted the Prophet ﷺ down. Why? Because he's been warned against him. But because he's a poet, he's heard the Prophet ﷺ is a spectacular poet. So he wants to meet somebody of his own type. So he goes to the Prophet ﷺ, and listen, look at his arrogance here. He says, I have heard that you have eloquent speech. I have something similar to you. We are both the same. Because he is the poet of the Khazraj. And so the Prophet ﷺ says, what do you have? Let me listen to it. So he recites his poetry, which I have no... of course, the eloquence is such that, to be honest, even I have to look up words and whatnot, and I don't think even any of you would be able to understand it. But clearly it is at an advanced level, right? And he is... And Ibn Hisham and Ibn... and others, not Ibn Hisham, other books mention some of his poetry, which is typical, beautiful, classical, pre-Islamic poetry, right? So he goes, this is what I have. The Prophet ﷺ says, هَذَا حَسَنْ وَمَا عِنْدِي أَحْسَنْ. What you have is good, but what I have is better. What you have is good, but what I have is better. Because what I have is تَنْزِيلٌ مِنْ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. So, Suwayd said, let me hear. So the Prophet ﷺ began reciting the Qur'an to him. And Suwayd was dumbstruck, speechless. You can't compete with the Qur'an. You cannot compete with the Qur'an. And so Suwayd said, let me think about this. This is deep. Let me think about it. Suwayd returned to Yathrib, and it was in that year that the Battle of Bu'ath took place, and he died in the Battle of Bu'ath. Later on, his people, his tribes, the Banu Auf, said, we are certain that he died a Muslim. This is their assumption of Suwayd. We are certain that he died a Muslim. There are also other references. One of them is to a young man from one of the tribes of the Khazraj, that when the Prophet ﷺ approached him, he almost converted. But the chieftain of the Khazraj said to him, get back, أقبل على شيء, get back, mind your own business. Don't worry about this guy. We're coming for another reason. Don't worry about it. So he returned back to Yathrib as well. And he was stabbed in the Battle of Bu'ath. And as he's dying, he began saying the tasbih and the tahmid and the takbir. Subhanallah, alhamdulillah, Allahu Akbar. And he died with the tasbih and tahmid coming from him. And this is again before sajda, before salah. This is of course in those days, right? So there are references to Islam having reached Yathrib before any treaty of Aqaba, before anything happening. So there are some stories, but the main conversion, the first conversion, takes place in the 10th year of the da'wah. The 10th year, the same year Abu Talib dies. Abu Talib dies Ramadan or Shawwal, yani around this time. Again, we don't have exact dates, but roughly around this time. Therefore, the next month, 2 months later, Dhul Qa'dah or Dhul Hijjah. Again, we don't know exactly, but roughly, because people would come before Hajj and then stay and then go back after Hajj. The Prophet ﷺ is making his rounds in Mina. And of course, he's concentrating on the big tribes. The Banu Kalb, the Banu Kinda, the Banu Hanifa, these are the big tribes. And by the way, as a footnote, as we always say, it is clear that the Prophet ﷺ is interested in the heavyweights. It's common sense. And you don't equate somebody whose conversion might lead to a whole tribe converting the same as somebody whose conversion might be prevented by the chieftain, as has happened. Right? And this is a part of the wisdom of Islam. So he's going on his way to the major tribes, and he sees a small group at Aqaba. You know where the Aqaba, where the stones are thrown. Aqaba. He sees a small group at Aqaba, close to what is now Masjid al-Khayf. And he says, Man al-Qawm. This time Abu Bakr is not with him. Man al-Qawm. Who are you? So they said, we are from the Khazraj. So he thinks, which Khazraj? It's not one of the big tribes. It's not one of, and Abu Bakr is not there to help him out. Which Khazraj? The Khazraj that are from the neighbors of the Yahud? Because he's trying to figure which Khazraj? And what he's trying to, he's wanting to some memory connections here, right? Which Khazraj? Is it the Khazraj who are the neighbors of the Yahud, i.e. from Yathrib? They said, yes, Khazraj who are the neighbors of the Yahud. So the Prophet said, may I speak with you? They said, yes, go ahead. So he sat down and he explained to them the teachings of Islam, recited to them the Quran, explained to them Tawheed, and warned them against Shirk with the same passion, the same sincerity, the same zeal as he used for the Banu Hanifa, the Banu Kinda, the Banu Sa'ad, all of the big tribes, even though they were but six people without any tent. This is not one of the rich tribes. This is not, and the Khazraj, by the way, we'll come to this later on, the Khazraj were the not the more richer tribe, let's say. They were the poorer tribe. The Aus were the ones who owned more, the Aus were the more business inclined, and the Khazraj were the ones who were the more farmers and laborers, right? And generally speaking, businessmen to this day are the ones who have more money than the workers. Even the doctors know this, right? You might get a good salary, but the real rich have to go into business. So it was the Aus who were more into the business, and it was the Khazraj who was the more into the farming and taking care of the land. So the Khazraj don't even have a tent. They don't even have a large, nothing. Just six people sitting there. So the Prophet ﷺ said, can I speak with you? They spoke, and he told them the teachings of Islam. And he moved on. And subhanallah, Allah Azza wa Jal had willed that Islam would be helped by this obscure tribe whom the Prophet did not even recognize. Not by the massive tribes or the mega glorious tribes of Kinda and the Banu Kalb and the Hanifa. No, by one of the smallest tribes. And this shows us an amazing point here, that we are never supposed to trivialize any opportunity that presents itself to us. Wama yudrin, how do we know what will happen with this opportunity when we do good? We might trivialize the person, but Allah knows this person will go and change an ummah afterwards. And so indeed the Prophet is concentrating on the elite, but he doesn't ignore the others. And that's the whole point. He's concentrating on the powerful, but when he passes by the Banu Khazraj, he gives them the same passion, the same da'wah, the same message, with the same zeal as everybody else. And he moves on his way. And these six people convert to Islam. The first major converts from outside of Mecca come from Banu Khazraj. Now, why did that happen? I mean, why did these people convert to Islam? Well, of course, firstly we say that indeed it is up to Allah Azza wa Jal whom He chooses. And Allah had chosen the people of Yathrib and the people of Khazraj to become basically the first Islamic Republic. But secondly, and there are reasons other than, of course, yani Allah's wisdom that works in alternative ways, right? That there's wisdoms that Allah had placed in front of us to see and benefit from. And of them is that the Khazraj were a group of people, the only Arab group in the region that had knowledge of monotheistic religions. They're interacting with the Yahud. So they understand the concept of Tawheed, of Risala and Nubuwa, of Ibadah and rituals, of law and ethics coming from a book, scripture, right? These are alien concepts for the Arabs. The Arabs don't know the concept of prophets, right? لِتُنذِرَ قَوْمًا مَا أَتَاهُمْ مِنْ نَذِيرٍ مِنْ قَبْلِكَ, so that you may warn a nation who's never had a prophet before you. They've never seen a prophet, but the Khazraj know what a prophet is. And the Khazraj understand what a book does. And the Khazraj felt inferior to the Yahud, because the Yahud had a higher civilization than them. The Yahud could read and write. The Yahud had madrasas. The Yahud had places of worship. And the Khazraj were always, and the Aus as well, both of them, they were always feeling inferior to the Yahud. And the Yahud flouted this. The Yahud made it a point of, we are better than you. And we have a book, and we have a prophet, and we have this and that. The Yahud flouted it, and of course, their religion does not allow conversion. Right? Their religion is ethnic religion. It doesn't allow conversion. You cannot become one if you wanted to, unless with great difficulty. And this Arab didn't even have these difficulties, the Arab Yahud at that time. So basically, they're flouting their superiority and not giving the Aus and Khazraj any opportunity to convert. And this is happening for generations and generations, right? So this flouting of arrogance worked against them. Do you see how now, right? That the Yahud are claiming that they're superior, the Khazraj understand Tawheed now. They understand what it means to have a book. Now an opportunity presents itself, and they have an opportunity to have the same civilization, the same type of book and law and ethics and morality that has been flouted in their face for the last 100 years. Additionally, the Yahud were boasting against the Arabs. And this is mentioned in the Quran. What were they saying? Who can tell me? What is the verse? يَسْتَفْتِحُونَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا فَلَمَّا جَاءَهُمْ مَا عَرَفُوا كَفَرُوا بِهِ. Allah references it indirectly. وَكَانُوا مِنْ قَبْلُ يَسْتَفْتِحُونَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا. This is the reference. What is the reference? The Yahud would say to the Aus and the Khazraj, whenever these battles would take place, because the Yahud also got involved in the civil war. The Yahud also had battles with each other over these issues. And so the Yahud, in their moments of irritation, would say to the Aus and Khazraj, it's only a matter of time before we win over you. We'll massacre you down to the last person. Because we're waiting for a prophet who's about to come. And as soon as he comes, it'll be over. وَكَانُوا مِنْ قَبْلُ يَسْتَفْتِحُونَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا. They would say they're going to win over the pagans. فَلَمَّا جَاءَهُمْ مَا عَرَفُوا. When this, what they were waiting for, came to them, كَفَرُوا بِهِ. They rejected it. They were waiting for a prophet to come. They were waiting for a new message. They were waiting for a new book. But when it came in the Quraysh, كَفَرُوا بِهِ. Right? So, this boasting backfired. This arrogance backfired. The Aus and the Khazraj were, all of a sudden the tables are turned. And they see an opportunity to embrace the religion, the faith, the iman, the book, the risala that they had been deprived of, and deep down inside they know has got to be true. Right? Because they've seen the civilization of the Yahud. And so, the six people who were with the Prophet ﷺ, they converted to Islam and they returned back home, spreading the message of Islam. And amongst them were some of the famous of the Ansar. All of you should know the name of Jabir ibn Abdullah. He is of the six. And even though he was very young at the time, perhaps even pre-baligh, but he was with his tribe. There was also Uqba ibn Amir, another famous Ansari. As'ad ibn Zurara. As'ad ibn Zurara has many stories in the early Seerah. All of these were of this initial six tribe. And six converts. And they converted to Islam, and they went back, and they began spreading the message of Islam until, in the next few months, everybody in the city of Yathrib, which would be called Medina in a year and a half, everybody had heard of the new message, and knew that some of their own had converted, and they were curious and interested, what is this man, and what is his message that has caused six of our own to convert. And what is really amazing about this story, and you know, to me especially, I've given an entire lecture at Isna and other places just about this incident, to derive benefits from it, that the Prophet ﷺ was being equally sincere to all the tribes. And he's just literally like throwing seeds. Allah knows where they're going to be planted. Allah knows which one will give fruit. And he plants the seeds in the Khazraj and didn't expect anything to come from the Khazraj. He himself said so. He himself said so. That when I was in Mecca, Allah showed me that I would be immigrating to another land. So he knows there's going to be another tribe accepting him, right? And he showed it to me, and it was a land of greenery, a land of palm trees. So, I thought that it might be in Yemen. He wants the big tribes. He wants civilization. He wants all of this, right? فَإِذَا هِيَ يَثْرِبْ. But rather it turned out to be Yathrib. Right? And he then changed the name of Yathrib to Madinah. And the point here, the Prophet ﷺ did not expect it to come from Yathrib. Neither was Yathrib on his immediate radar. But he gave the people of Yathrib the attention, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him back the fruit. And this is an important lesson for us. As I said, we should never trivialize any opportunity, any good that we see, a potential to do good, any type of khair, any type of da'wah. Allahu a'lam, this person we give da'wah to, what he's going to become, who is going to do that. Allahu a'lam. It's not, only Allah knows best. And because our Prophet ﷺ did not trivialize the da'wah, this initial seed of six people gave fruit, and the next year, more than double the number came back. The next year, more than 10 times that quantity came back. And the next year, they demanded from the Prophet ﷺ, you're not going to live amongst those persecution people who are persecuting you. You will come to us with izzah and honor, and we will give our lives and our souls to protect you. Right? That da'wah gave its thamara. That planting of the seed gave its fruit in just 3.5 years. And Allah Azza wa Jal, وَمَن يَتَّقِ اللَّهَ يَجْعَلْ لَهُ مَخْرَجًا وَيَرْزُقْهُ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا يَحْتَسِبْ. Allah will provide, but you won't expect from where, you won't know from where. But if you have taqwa and sincerity, this is what we find from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And inshallah, next week we'll come back and resume the da'wah of the people of Yathrib, which was to be called Medina, and how eventually the tide changed so quickly that within 2.5 years, just 2.5 years, that's it, an entire city could be demanding, we want you to come and be our leader. What an amazing change. Not just we're going to adopt you and be one of our tribesmen, as the Arab tribes were saying. No, as he was asking from the Arab tribes, he wasn't asking to be their leader. He was simply saying, adopt me and protect me so that I can spread the message. And subhanallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed him in a manner that of course would forever change history after that. And this is of course the wisdom of Allah, the planning of Allah, the power of Allah. We'll resume inshallah next week. Now we will open the floor for questions inshallah, and then break for Salat al-Isha. Questions about this interim period? Yes. Yes, go ahead.
You said that there are seven samawat, and the Prophet is above the seven samawat. So when are the
I actually did say this, so let's see who can remember. Where are the jannat in respect to the samawat? We said that it appears that the jannat are in the seventh heaven, and they might begin in the sixth, because we have one riwayah that says that the roots of Sidrat al-Muntaha are in the sixth heaven, in the sixth sama. So perhaps the roots are in the sixth, and then the jannat are all the seventh, and perhaps the jannat began in the sixth and continue to the seventh. We don't know that much detail, but we know that the very end of Jannah is of course Firdaus, and Firdaus is the highest of the creation, and above the Firdaus is the throne of Allah Azza wa Jal, and therefore Sidrat al-Muntaha ends in Firdaus. Sidrat al-Muntaha ends in Firdaus, and above that is the throne of Allah Azza wa Jal. That's all we know, and to be honest, I personally do not believe that our minds can even comprehend or imagine that world or anything. Is beyond our comprehension. I personally believe, yani, if we cannot even understand how this entire creation is just the first sama, what is beyond this? I mean, that's it, our minds are blank. This everything that we see is still within the first sama. Sama ad-dunya. This is sama ad-dunya. What is beyond this? We can't even understand what is in this world. Right? Do you think we'll understand? So, in my humble opinion, this is just words that we say. As Ibn Abbas said, there is nothing of the Akhirah that we'll understand except the names used. Apple, apple. Jannah, Jannah. Garden, garden. But that's the only thing that's the same. The realities of the apples, the realities of the gardens, you'll never understand. There's nothing of this world in the next, he said, except for the name. That's all there is. This is what Ibn Abbas said. And if this is for what Allah has given us explicit descriptions of, how about that which Allah has not given explicit descriptions of, and that is what is in the other samawat, and is there other creation or whatnot? All of this, Wallahu ta'ala a'lam. We don't know. Yes? Did any of the Yahud accept Islam? Indeed they did. Of course, Abdullah ibn Salam is the greatest example. But there are others as well. Abdullah ibn Salam was their most famous convert, but there are a number, a handful, who did accept Islam, and we will talk about this when we get to the Yahud, inshallah. Yes, go ahead.
In the first six that converted, were there any members of the Aus around there at the time during that time?
No, see, the Khazraj were camped in their own camp.
Right, was there a camp of the
Aus? There are no reports of the Aus converting at this time. So we don't even know, did they come, did they not come? All we know is that the Prophet ﷺ gave da'wah to the Khazraj, and six of the Khazraj converted. And even the next year, when 12 people converted, 90% of them were from the Aus. Only one or two were from the Aus. Because still, Islam will spread from family and friends, right? So very few of the Aus had converted initially. Khazraj was one of the mains to convert. And the reason, of course, is that the Khazraj, as we said, were of the lower socioeconomic status, and it's easier for them to convert to Islam. Yes, go ahead.
Rasul was asking, basically, political asylum to migrate to. Do you comment on those of us who migrate from Muslim lands for economic reasons? Sometimes Hadith says, everybody is what he migrates for. You migrate for the money, you migrate for the money.
فمن كانت هجرته لدنيا يصيبها أو امرأة ينكحها فهجرته إلى ما هاجر إليه. This is a very deep question which deserves more response. But in a nutshell, firstly, realize that the Prophet ﷺ did not say that it is haram to migrate for the dunya or for a woman. He simply said, if you do so, that's what you're doing it for. Correct? So, if you migrated for a land for economic reasons, it's for economic reasons. فَهِجْرَتُهُ إِلَى مَا هَجَرَ إِلَيْهِ. Right? So, don't call this a shar'i hijra. You have done a lughawi hijra. From your land to this land. This is not a shar'i hijra. So, this is not something that in and of itself will get you any reward when you did the deed. Second question. Can you convert the niyyah? You can always convert a niyyah, but the reward will be proportional to what you've done after the niyyah and not before. Okay? Third question. What is the permissibility of making linguistic hijra from an Islamic land to a land that is not Islamic? This is something that our scholars have discussed in our times, and in my humble opinion, it is completely ja'iz and permissible with some conditions. And of those conditions is that he have the freedom to practice sha'air al-Islam. Sha'air al-Islam means the main pillars of Islam, right? If any country does not allow you to practice the main rituals of Islam, you're not allowed to pray, you're not allowed to fast, you're not allowed to proclaim your Islam, right? Then it is not allowed to go to that land, because ardullahi wasi'a, go find a place where you're able to do that. First condition. Second condition, that he has enough iman from which and through which he feels confident or expects to be able to avoid the major sins. And as for the minor sins, this is everywhere in the world. But at least the major sins, that he shall avoid the kaba'ir. And the third condition, he has enough ilm that he feels he is safe from doubting his faith. Okay, so there's three basic conditions that need to be met. Number one, there must be freedom in the land. Number two, there must be enough iman that he's able to live as a Muslim without, and this is, of course, there's never a guarantee. Rather, this is your your husn al-dhan with Allah Azza wa Jal, you can become the fasiq even in your country. Right? And you can become a fasiq in this land as well. So there has to be ghalabat al-dhan, there has to be tawakkul in Allah. And number three, enough ilm that you're not worried about you or your children, a'udhu billah, becoming murtad. You protect your faith in this regard. Now, as for the issue that some people have, that the only reason that it is allowed to live in a non-Islamic land is if you are giving da'wah. I do not agree with this phrase in such an unconditional blanket manner, because there is no evidence for it. Rather, if you are living in a land as a practicing Muslim for the sake of the dunya, then you are not committing any sin, and your reward will be for your Islam. No doubt, if you were to do more and above and beyond, this is good and you will get rewarded. But to make it a condition upon all of the Muslims, not only is this impossible because most Muslims are not qualified to give da'wah, it is also burdening them with something that Allah has not burdened them with. Allah has burdened you with the five pillars, with avoiding the major sins. Do this and you are safe. And you will not be punished for not going above and beyond what this is. Now, by the way, da'wah also means people know you're a Muslim. This is da'wah. Khalas. You don't have to go knocking on doors or preaching in synagogues and churches. You are a Muslim. Your co-workers know this. This is da'wah. Okay? Your friends know this. Your relatives, your neighbors know this. This is da'wah. That's good enough da'wah. So you don't have to go above and beyond this point. Also, the point, there was an extreme opinion that still is common to this day. You still find people saying this, that it is haram to live in a non-Muslim land because the Prophet ﷺ said this and that. The fact of the matter is, all of these ahadith do not indicate that it is haram to do so. Rather, there are authentic narrations that he allowed Muslims of his time to live in non-Muslim lands with conditions. The most important is, of course, the Abyssinians, right? Secondly, there is no Dar al-Islam that we can apply these ahadith upon anyway. There is no Khalifa, there is no anything of this nature such that we say there is Dar al-Islam and then there is Dar al-Kufr, right? Thirdly, there's a whole modern talk going on about dividing the world into Dar al-Islam and Dar al-Kufr and Dar al-this and Dar al-that. Where does it come from? And the fact of the matter is that these distinctions come from early fuqaha, early scholars. They don't come from the Quran. There's nothing in the Quran about this. There's nothing explicit in the hadith that divides the world into two or three or four or five or six. And that's why early scholars divided the world into two or three or four or five or six, depending on which scholar. Therefore, when we understand this, then there is no problem in actually going back to the Quran and Sunnah and redefining the territories of the world with a new description that is not found in the classical books, because this is not... Now, if Allah had said the world is of two types, khalas, end of story. If the Prophet has said the world should be divided into three, khalas, end of story. But it's not. We don't find Quran and Hadith. Rather, this is from the ijtihad of the early scholars. And then they applied rules. Dar al-Islam, Dar al-Harb, Dar al-Kufr, Dar al-Ahd. What should each one be done? All of this talk generated in a particular political climate. We need to, our scholars, not the average Muslims, our scholars need to go back to the books, go back to the Quran and Sunnah, and have a similar discussion. What does it mean to be a citizen in a Western democracy? What does it mean to be a citizen in a land that guarantees you freedom of religion, guarantees you freedom of expression? Right? Can we take a book from the 7th century and open up Dar al-Kufr, these are the rulings, and then cut and paste to America? In my humble opinion, no, we cannot do this. Right? We need to rethink things through. And this is where one of the areas where I think reform is definitely needed, because it's not explicit in the text. So this is a deep topic. I didn't think you realize the profundity of it, but this is a topic that many scholars are thinking about. Tariq Ramadan has written many books about this, and I agree with much of what he has written, what it means to be a Western Muslim, what it means to be a European Muslim. These are very good books, and he is beginning the discussion and dialogue, and it needs to be taken further than this. But inshallah, it's a very profound question. The bottom line, I have a statement that I say, The people who are the most concerned about hijrah should be the last people to ever do it. Stay here. And the people who are the least concerned about hijrah, they're the ones we don't need. We'd rather they go back and live back home. So the very fact you're asking the question means what? Stay here. Stay here. Because we don't need, we need, because it means you're conscious of the religion. It means you're thinking of Islam and Allah Azza wa Jalla's commandments. We need you to stay. The American Ummah needs you. We need people like you. And as for those who couldn't care less about Islam, we never see them in the masjid, wallahi, they are better off going back home, right? Because their sins will be less and their Islam will be safer. Right? So the very fact you're asking means khalas, you must stay here, inshallah. Yes.
The sawab of those people of minority living in non-Islamic land, that their ibadahs, their prayer is different reward than the average Muslim who lives among majority Muslims.
So the brother is asking, is there any extra reward for being Muslim in difficult circumstances? Of course there is. Of course there is. The Prophet ﷺ warned us, the Sahaba, of a time that would come where the one who is faithful to his religion will be like al-qabidi ala al-jamr, will be like the one who is holding burning coals in his hand. Imagine coal, picking it up and holding it, qabidi ala al-jamr. And the Prophet ﷺ said, whoever does so will get ajru khamsina minkum, the reward of 50 of you. Even the Sahaba were shocked. They said, surely you mean 50 of them. And he said, no, 50 of you.
But she has that apply, if so, do they not?
No, I am not saying it applies to America 2012. But what does it show you? To be a Muslim at times of difficulty will get more reward. The Prophet said, hadith is in Musnad Imam Ahmad, al-ibadatu fil haraji kal-hijrati ilayya. Worshipping perfectly at times of chaos and strife, it is like making hijrah to me. You talk about hijrah? Worshipping Allah at times of bloodshed, chaos, fitna, being perfect in this time, it is like you're immigrating to me, because that's what you're doing basically. That's what you're doing. You're leaving the chaos and worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, right? So clearly there is no question that the one who worships Allah in difficult times will get more reward than the one who worships Allah at times of ease. And this is an inspiration and inshallah, a reason for us to look forward to our own situation and times.